663. Sing the first, third, and final verse. First, third, and last. Let's sing.
There is sunshine in my soul today.
Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you, but Crispus and Gaius, lest any should say that I have baptized in my own name. Please stand for the opening prayer.
Let's pray. Most righteous, loving, heavenly Father, we thank Thee for this beautiful and this glorious Lord's Day, which we have this opportunity to come here and worship Thee, the one, the true, and living God. And it's our prayer, Father, this morning that everything that we do here today will be in accordance to Thy will and will be well-pleasing in Thy sight. Father, we have so much to be thankful for. We have so many blessings. For one, this great country which we live, the freedom that we have to come here and assemble in Thy name without any fear coming of any harm coming unto us for doing so. And we're so thankful for the men and women who serve in our military that give us this freedom. We're so thankful for all the men and women who have given their lives in years past so that we can come here today. Father, we are thankful for the church. We're especially thankful for the church here at Skyline. We pray for its leaders, Father. We pray for each and every member that makes up this congregation. And we pray that You will continue to bless us in everything that we do. And we pray, Father, that as we strive to do Thy will here in this community, and we let our light so shine that You may continue to shower blessings upon us. Father, we are so thankful to have with us this morning Brother Mike. We're thankful for the great work in which he does and which he is part of, and that of Lads to Leaders. And we pray, Father, that as we embark upon that journey here at Skyline, that You will bless us in that effort. We pray that each family here will take the time to be a part of this great effort, to help to train up our youth, Father, so that there may be a future for the church of tomorrow. Father, we want to pray now for Brother Troy McNutt as he soon will be stepping into this pulpit delivering a message from Thy divine word. We pray that he may have a ready recollection of the things in which he studied, and he may teach them and preach them unto us, Father, in a simple manner in which we can all understand here this morning, that we may apply this message into our lives, and we can take the message, Father, Thy good word, and go out and teach others about Thee. It's our prayer, Father, here this morning that there may be some in attendance who have never obeyed Thy gospel, who have never put Christ on in baptism and come in contact with that precious blood. We pray that they will examine their lives and they will make that greatest decision that they'll ever make, and they will do so this morning, but they will not leave here in a lost condition. Father, we want to pray for the missionaries. We have so many who have chose to leave the great comforts of this land to go out into the uttermost parts of the world to spread the borders of Thy kingdom, which Thou hast commanded us to do. And we pray a special blessing for them this morning, Father, that there may be many teaching and preaching today that have to do so secretly, Father, because where they are teaching and preaching the word, it is not very accepted. And we pray that You give them the strength and the courage that they need to carry out the task today. Father, be with us all as we enter into this hour of worship. We pray that we may free our minds from the worldly distractions and focus solely upon the reason in which we have all come here today, and that's to worship Thee. Father, we are always mindful of those who are sick. We have so many that are ailing at this time, Father, so many of our own number and friends and family of our members, Father, that we wish to pray for. And we pray that You will be with these people, Father, that You will grant them a better portion of health. Father, we're always thankful and ever mindful of Thy Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, Him leaving Thy side in heaven and coming down to this earth to live His life among men, living a sinless and a perfect life, a life in which we can only strive to pattern our lives after and be like. We're so thankful for the sacrifice in which was made on our behalf upon that cruel cross on Calvary's Hill, the shedding of that precious blood, Father. We're so thankful for this great sacrifice. Father, we love Thee, and we pray that You will continue to bless us in everything in which we do. Bless us now, Father, as we enter into this worship hour. These things we pray in Jesus Christ, his holy and his blessed name. Amen.
Remain standing, if you will. It's that time of the week when we want to observe the Lord's Supper, as that early church did there in the New Testament. In order to do that, we'll prepare our minds by singing number 516. 516. 516. Do something a little different here, and we're going to sing the second, third, and fourth only. Second, third, and fourth. Let's sing.
One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on the tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Living he loved me, dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. One day they left him alone in the garden. One day he rested from suffering free. Angels came down o'er his tomb to keep vigil. Hope of the hopeless, my Savior is he. Living he loved me, dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended my Lord evermore. Living he loved me, dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day.
Maybe so.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this bread. It represents Christ's body. Dear Lord, I ask that the ones partake of this morning, take it in the manner that is pleasing in thy sight. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you. aside from the Lord's Supper, we are also commanded to give on the first day of the week. Today, give as you feel led to give. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you thankful for our jobs, Lord. Thankful for the ability to be able to perform our jobs, Lord. Lord, we're just thankful for the income that we have, Lord. And Lord, I pray that everyone that gives today, Lord, gives so in a manner that's pleasing to you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Corinthians chapter 1, which we will be going in just a moment as far as our lesson is concerned. In the world today, there are a number of, and I put in quotation marks, denominations. Now, when we use that term denomination, we also know from a biblical standpoint that Jesus in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 10 prayed that we might be one. there be no divisions among us. That word denominations is divisive. The term itself means division. I've used this illustration before, the fact that we have our monetary values in America, and we have $1 bills, $5 bills, $10 bills, $20 bills, $50 bills, $100 bills, and there used to be years ago $1,000 bills. But be that as it may, these are each denominations of our monetary system that we use. Now, the word denomination, as I said, is against the principles of what the Bible teaches. And what we're going to talk about this morning is a very difficult question that many times is put before each and every one of us as members of the Lord's church. I would dare say that if we've done much talking to anyone religiously speaking, we have confronted this idea that you believe that you're the only ones going to heaven. Now, how do we answer that question, and how do we deal with that question? Anyone who has been a Christian for any period of time, a faithful child of God, has heard the following, and you have them listed. If you have a bulletin, you should have them listed. Can you believe that he and his little group believe they have a monopoly on worship and heaven? Secondly, the audacity of them to believe that they are the only ones who are right, religiously speaking. Number three, who do these people think they are passing judgment on other religious groups? Number four, don't they know that Christ died for all people and not just for them, members of the Church of Christ? And then finally, how self-righteous they are in believing that only their little group will be saved. Now, these are comments that we hear from time to time as members of the Lord's church. And it's sad, but yet it's true that many people hold this against the Lord's church, this very idea that you think you're the only ones going to heaven. In the world today, there are very few people that study God's word. I'm talking about study God's word. I'm not talking about reading God's word. People all the time read their Bibles, but most people study their Bibles very little. They may read a passage from the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, as we are going to read this morning. And they never make application to any other passage in all the Bible pertaining to that reading in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. How we study the Bible is very important. People sometimes who read the Bible, but they read with some problems. First of all, bias. They read with bias. They also read with a preconceived idea. They also read with personal feelings. What they think, it doesn't matter what the Bible says, but their personal feelings. And then sometimes they read and they believe what they believe because they put their trust in what someone else says rather than a thus saith the Lord. That's very easily, when you have that particular problem, being biased, preconceived ideas, personal feelings, what other people say, not be able to reach and draw what the Bible teaches as the truth of God's word. The only way that we can understand what God says is not by what other people say, not by what I think, you think, or anybody else in the world thinks, but what does the Bible say? That's what we have to base our findings upon. He said, she said, it's not worth a damn, not even in a court of law. You know that, and I know that. But when it comes to truth, many times truth suffers because of the fact people in the world have no inkling of what the Bible teaches. And that's sad. How sad it is. You remember in Hosea chapter 4 and verse 6, the Lord said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Most assuredly, even in the Lord's church today, we are on the verge of not studying our Bibles as we should and as we ought, and making application to our lives with it. Oh, we hear it preached, but we don't live it. We hear what the preacher says, we know what the Word of God says, but we do what we want to do because we feel it's all right. Well, feelings will get us in trouble many times. Now this morning I want us to take these five things that are said from time to time by the religious world. I want us to take our Bibles and discover the truth about God's Word. First of all, I want you to take your Bible and turn to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. We must understand, as children of God, that what God says is the truth of the matter, not what I think. In Matthew chapter 7, beginning with verse 21, we ought to know this passage by memory by now, as much as I use it. Not every one that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of the Father which is in heaven. Now I want to stop there and I want to ask a question. Are those that are going to heaven, are they going to have to do the will of the Father in order to make it to heaven? And of course, the obvious answer is yes. Because Jesus said, he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. In verse 22, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? In thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. There are going to be those on the judgment day that stand before Christ that are going to say, now Jesus, stop and wait for just a moment. I want you to think. Do you not remember when I did some wonderful things in thy name? They did it in the name of Jesus. Somehow, some way in the world today, we think if we do something in the name of Jesus, we've done something wonderful. Now, don't get me wrong. If we do it the right way, the way that Jesus says do it, it is a wonderful thing. But simply because we do something in the name of Jesus doesn't make it right. You see, there's a big difference. Now, what do I want to do? Do I want to be right with God? Or do I want to satisfy my own conscience, my own heart? Because the key to it is being right with God. He that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Look at verse 23. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Now, how in the world could Jesus make such a statement? In the religious world today, and all the chaos that we have today, how in the world could Jesus say on the judgment day, then will I profess unto them, I never knew you? How in the world could he do that to someone who is religious? The Pharisees were religious. But in Matthew chapter 23, he eat them up one side and down the other because of their hypocrisy. Being religious is not what Christianity is about, brethren. Being godly, being virtuous, that's what Christianity is all about. It's not the fact that we come together and we play church Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. Yes, that's good to come to church, don't get me wrong. But is that what Christianity is all about, coming to church services? Absolutely not. Far more involved in Christianity than just attending the services. That's just a part, a small part of Christianity today. And when we talk about this idea of the Bible and doing what the Bible says, look with me again in Luke chapter 6 and verse 46. Luke 6, verse 46. And why call you me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? A lot of people call Jesus Lord, Lord of their lives. They've turned their lives over to the Lord. But Jesus said, just saying Lord, Lord doesn't do it. There are certain things that one must do in order to be right with God. You remember in the book of Romans chapter 15 and verse 4, whatsoever things written aforetime written for our learning. that we through patient comfort scriptures might have hope. Now, the Old Testament written for our learning. Now, if we study the Old Testament, we see character after character after character, but never do we see any characters in the Old Testament that did not have to be obedient to God. Everybody had to be obedient to God. Noah, when he built the ark, the only reason Noah was saved was that God saw that he was a righteous man. And the Bible says that Noah did all that God commanded. He was obedient to God in every aspect, every way, not just in one or two. There are good things in the religious world that are going on. Not everything that's happening in denominationalism is wrong, brethren. But what is happening that is wrong is enough to cause us to be lost if we're not doing it the way God says to do it. And we're not believing what God tells us pertaining to his truth. Abraham in Genesis chapter 22 was one who was tried or proved by God with Isaac his son. And Isaac was to be sacrificed. You remember it was through Abraham's seed, Isaac being that seed, that all the nations of the earth would be blessed. And here's Abraham now told by God, I want you to take your son Isaac, go to Mount Moriah, 3 days' journey, and I want you to sacrifice your son unto me. What do you mean? And you see Abraham arguing with God. God, what do you mean? Take my son to Mount Moriah. Isn't it through his seed we're supposed to be blessed? No, the Bible didn't say Abraham argued with God. The Bible says the next morning, he and his servants and his lad, his son Isaac, rose and they went 3 days' journey, came to Mount Moriah. He told his servants, you stay here with the animals. My son and I will go to the mountain and we shall return. I find it interesting. He said, we shall return. Because God said, you're going to sacrifice your son to me. You see how much faith Abraham had in God? He knew that if God were to kill his son, he'd bring him back alive again, because God had promised through my seed all the nations of the earth would be blessed. Abraham was obedient to God's will, even though it was a very difficult obedience. And we could go on and on throughout the history of obedience unto God. Never in the Old Testament did God not require obedience from his children. So, with that said, let's stop and go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 now. We read a few moments ago in chapter 1, verse 10, now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you. Now, what is Paul telling the Corinthians? God expects for you people to get along. He expects that there would be no divisions among you, doctrinally, personally, or any other way as far as that matter is concerned, but that ye be perfect, joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. That idea of being perfectly joined together is as a picture frame. You know, a picture frame can be a beautiful thing if you make the joints just seem like they grow together. And that's what he's talking about. We as a congregation of God's people are to be perfectly joined together as that frame on that picture frame. That joint on that picture frame. There's not to be divisions among us. And yet, in the religious world, how divided are we? In America alone, there are over 3,000 different religious beliefs. We couldn't name them all if we wanted to. And yet we talk about unity. Friends, there cannot be unity when we're divided. You can never have unity with division. It just doesn't work that way. It can't happen that way. Either we're united or we're divided. It's the only way it can be. One or the other. Can't have both. But a lot of people like to be divided, but yet we're going to agree to disagree. Well, agreeing to disagree doesn't change the word of God, brethren. When here is one denomination that believes a certain way pertaining to baptism, here is another denomination that believes another way pertaining to baptism, and then here is the Bible that tells us what one must do as far as baptism is concerned, which one is right? I'll take the Bible. Why? Because I know it's the word of God, and the word of God is truth. And I don't have to worry about it. But if I take someone else's word and what they're teaching, see, we can't all be right on baptism if we're teaching different teachings. Somebody has to be wrong, or somebody's have to be wrong. There's where study comes in. This is where the religious world gives up. They don't care so long as they're religious and show their piety to God. You remember the book of Isaiah chapter 2? Isaiah the prophet wrote, God speaking through Isaiah the prophet, and God said, I am sick of your vain oblations. That worship you're giving to me is not worth a dime because you're not living a life. You see, God wants it done right. Why didn't they dab into Bahi? Why were they stricken dead by God? Because they disobeyed God. What did they do? The Bible says they offered a strange fire. What difference does it make? Preacher, fire is fire. Yes, fire is fire. It will burn. It will do the same thing. But when God tells someone where to get that fire, better get it from where he tells you to get it and not get it from some other place, because God struck Nadab and Abihu dead, consumed with fire, because of the fact they didn't get it where they're supposed to. That's being mighty picky, being mighty legalistic, preacher. I'm only as legalistic as the Lord is. And God said and told them very plainly where to get that fire. And they offered strange fire unto God. Now, when it comes to the Lord's church, herein lies a problem that we have, because many in the religious world go to John chapter 15 and they want to talk about the one true church worldwide. And there is one true church worldwide, but it has nothing to do with denominationalism. It has nothing to do with denominational churches, because Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. Jesus wanted everyone to be a member of the church by which he purchased with his own blood. That church and that church only. Now here's the problem once again. Which one is it, preacher? That's where study comes in. That's where you have to open your Bible. If you're not willing to open your Bible and study God's word, then you're going to find yourself in a false religion, in a false denomination. And the reason is because you haven't taken the time, the initiative, to study God's word. Study is important to the Christian. We must study day after day after day, and we must never quit studying the whole time we live here upon earth. But I want us to take these five things that we talked about earlier, as far as, for instance, can you believe that he and his little group believe that they have a monopoly on worship in heaven? First of all, the terminology "he and his little group" is inappropriate. It's not my group, friends. I am a member of the Lord's church. I did absolutely nothing. I've done absolutely nothing to buy nor purchase the church which Jesus purchased in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 18. Jesus said, I will build my church, singular. I know that rubs against the grain of anyone in denominationalism, but friends, I didn't write the Bible. All I'm doing is telling you what Jesus said. I will build my church. One church. Not 5,000, not 5 million. Jesus said, I will build my church. You remember in Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, when the gospel was preached by Peter for the first time, the Bible tells us that some 3,000 souls obeyed the gospel. And in the last verse of that chapter, it says, and the Lord added to the denominations. No. The Lord added to the church such as should be saved. What did he add them to? The church. Did he add them to a denomination? Absolutely not. We as members of the Church of Christ deny being a denomination. We are not a denomination. We are the one true church of which the Bible speaks of. Now, we may not always act like we are. I will grant you that. We don't always do what's right, do we? But we're no different than anyone else in the world because they don't either. But friends, the terminology, he and his little group, I don't have a group. I don't own a group. I didn't pay for a group. It is not a little group. It's God's church. You can call them what you want to. It doesn't change the fact that the church was purchased by Jesus Christ. Second of all, he says the audacity then to believe that they are the only ones who are right, religiously speaking. A child of God does have exclusive privileges. Notice I said a child of God does have exclusive privileges there. Take your Bible and turn to Hebrews chapter 5. In Hebrews chapter 5, look at verse 9, the Apostle Paul writing. I believe he'd be the author of Hebrews. But in chapter 5, verse 9, and being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that what? That obey him. If I obey Jesus, then I have special privileges. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. Not everyone that saith to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. There are privileges that come with membership. You go to Sam's Club or to Costco or some other big group, and you buy a membership. You pay X amount of dollars to be a member of Sam's or Costco or whatever. You buy your membership. Membership in the Lord's church has privileges. Membership in Sam's has privileges. Membership in Costco has privileges. Someone who doesn't belong to Costco cannot go in and buy. Someone who does not belong to Sam's cannot go in and buy unless, first of all, they pay their membership dues. We understand that. And when it comes to the Lord's church, membership has privileges. Read the book of Ephesians chapter 1. Blessing after blessing after blessing for being a child of God. Privileges that are ours. Nobody else in the world has those. Only those who are in Christ Jesus have those privileges. And so when someone says here the audacity then to believe they're the only ones right, listen, whether you believe it or not, religiously speaking, many in the denominational world believe the very same thing. Because if they truly, truly believed what they taught, it wouldn't matter where they went to church at, because Christians are in every denomination, according to their thinking. See what I'm saying? As members of the Lord's church, we are to worship according to God's plan. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. In other words, the way we worship God is very important. One being a member of the Lord's church does not give him freedom to do what he or she chooses when it comes to worship. We are bound by the doctrine of Christ. Therefore, third of all, when it is said, who do these people think they are passing judgment on a religious group? First of all, I haven't passed judgment on a religious group. Read with me, if you would, in the book of Matthew, chapter 15. In Matthew chapter 15 and verse 13, but he answered and said, Jesus speaking, every plant which my heavenly Father hath not planted shall be rooted up. Who spoke that? Who said that? I didn't say it. I read it. The Bible says, if the Lord did not plant it, it shall be rooted up. The third thing is that the Lord has pass judgment, not man. Not the church of Christ. The church of Christ hasn't placed judgment. Christ did. Christ has the right to place judgment. He's the one that died on the cross for our sins, for your sins, for my sins. He has the right to say who's right and who's wrong, who's in, who's out. And I think he pretty much said it. Every plant which my Heavenly Father has not planted is what? Going to be rooted up. I didn't make that judgment. You know, people get so tore up over the fact, they say, you know, we're not to judge, you're not to judge. The Bible doesn't say you're not to judge. Nowhere in the Bible does the Bible say thou shalt not judge. The Bible says be careful how you judge. For as you judge, so shall you be judged. It's the attitude. He's not condemning judgment. We all make judgment every day. Parents make judgment for their children every day as to what's right and what's wrong, what they'll let them do, what they won't let them do. That's judgment. Christ has the same right of judgment, does he not? As to who can be a part of his church and who cannot be. If we're obedient to his will, we do what he says in order to get into Christ, then God is willing to add them to the church. But if I'm not willing to do what Christ said, what God said, then God doesn't have the right. He doesn't owe me anything. He doesn't owe me salvation. Let me tell you something, brethren. We get this thing all turned around. God don't owe us anything. We owe God everything. We need to start thinking correctly. God doesn't owe you anything. You owe him everything. And so it is when we think we pass judgment. We haven't passed judgment. Christ has. I read his words. You read them yourself. Fourth of all, don't they know that Christ died for all people and not just for them? That is members of the Church of Christ. Yes, it is true. I don't deny that Christ died for all men. God wants all men everywhere to be saved. God is not slack concerning his promise, but is long-suffering to us, would not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But notice, God's not willing that any should perish, but that what? All should come to repentance. Jesus wants everyone saved. God wants everyone saved, but it's left up to us. You see, brethren, Christ has done all he can do. What more do we want Christ to do for us? I mean, we want to do it our way. We're kind of like Burger King, have it your way, and we want our religion to be the same thing. So long as we're religious, it doesn't matter what we do. We're all going to the same place, trying to just taking different paths to get there. Well, there's not but one way, friends, as we'll see in just a moment. Judgment is passed by Jesus and God, not by man. Fourth of all, well, I think that's probably what I said. Fourth of all, fourth, Christ did die for the entire world, but he only promised to save his body. Christ died for the sins of the whole world, but he only promised to save his body. Now, a good question might be, what is the body of Christ? Well, the body of Christ is the church. Look with me, if you would, in the book of Ephesians. In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22, 23, and hath put all things under his feet, that is, speaking of Christ, gave him to be head over all things to the church, notice, which is his body. The church is the body of Christ. Each and every member of the body of Christ makes up the church. That's why in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul pleaded, he said, you can't just throw a member out because you want to. Everybody has to work together to have the unity as a congregation of God's people. We all have to do our part. You can't cut your arm off. If you do, your body doesn't function like it should. You don't cut your leg off simply because you want to cut your leg off because you know you need that leg. And the church is the same way. Brethren, we need each other. We need each other. In Colossians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul, in writing to the brethren there in verse 18, says, and he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. Yes, Christ died for the world, but he only promised to save those who are obedient to his will, to his body. Finally, how self-righteous are they in believing that only their little group will be saved? Well, number five, I left a three-letter word out, and it makes a big difference in what is said. Fifth, one is guilty. He's not guilty. He is not guilty of self-righteousness who faithfully does what the Lord says to be saved. When I am faithful to God, I do what He tells me to do as far as salvation is concerned, then I am not self-righteous. I am righteous in the sight of God when I obey His will. Now, I want you to take your Bible and turn with back again to Matthew chapter 7, not verse 21 this time, but verse 13 and 14. We're going to close this thing out. Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be that go in thereat, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. We see from Matthew chapter 16 and verse 18, when Jesus promised to build His church, He didn't promise to build a man-made church. He promised to build the church. It would never, ever go away. It will always be. Daniel chapter 2, the prophecy pertaining to that. Remember, Daniel had that dream. Nebuchadnezzar had the dream. Daniel interpreted it. He said there would be a kingdom that would be established to live forever and ever and ever. That is the church. The church is going to live on even while after we're gone. There's going to be the church. There's only one body, Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 4. The one body is described as being the church. Ephesians chapter 1, 22 and 23, Christ purchased His own church by His blood, Acts 20 and verse 28. Now, with this passage that we just read here in Matthew chapter 7, 13 and 14, I want to make some application to it real fast. Christ said He would build His church, not a man-made church, right? Is that straight and narrow or broad and wide? Christ built His church. How many churches? One church. Is that straight and narrow or broad and wide? It's pretty narrow, isn't it? Only one. Not many. Paul taught there's only one body, which is clearly described as being the church. Ephesians 1, 22 and 23. Is this one body straight and narrow or broad and wide? Well, it's narrow. There's not but one. Did Christ purchase only His church with His blood in Acts 20, 28? Or did He purchase everybody else's church with His own blood? Was this purchase straight and narrow or broad and wide? It was straight and narrow. Jesus only purchased His church one. Christ surely did not die for and purchase His own blood for a church that does not even wear His name. How do the names Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Episcopalian, Lutheran, and all other such names honor and glorify God? It doesn't. Those are man-made. Martin Luther, John Calvin, and others. They do not. They do not reveal who owns the church. What is wrong with the designation Church of Christ? Romans 16, 16, the Church of Christ salutes you. Nothing. Because that's biblical. You see, we are said to be legalistic, narrow-minded, and that's exactly the way the Bible describes us. We are narrow-minded. We are as narrow as the Bible is narrow. We are as broad as the Bible will allow us to be broad. Friends, we have nothing to be ashamed of, and we have nothing to fear. Just because people make statements about us does not make it true. If you're here this morning, you're not a member of the Lord's church, the one church. I realize that's a difficult thought within itself. But there is but one church that Jesus died for. If you're willing to be a part of that church, God is willing to add you to that church. What must one do? He must first of all hear the word of God. Must believe it, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. He must repent of his sins, and here is by far the hard commandment, because you got to change your life now. It's not enough just to be baptized. You got to change your life. You got to put it in correspondence with the life of Christ. You won't never be like Christ, but it's how close can you get to being like Christ? That's repentance. confess that Jesus is the Christ in a public way and being baptized for the remission of your sins. That's how one gets into Christ, Galatians chapter 3, 26 and 27. If you're willing to do that, the Lord will add you to His church. If you're a member of the Lord's church and you've gone astray, you need to come back. Now all you need to do is to repent and ask the prayers of the church on your behalf so that you can once again stand pure and justified in God's sight. If you're subject, would you come as together and stand and sing?